Hello and welcome to the History Show on Near 90 FM. This is a new series where we will be exploring different aspects of Irish history. My name is Cathal Brennan and my co-presenter is John Dorney of theirishstory.com. We'd love to hear your feedback on the show, and if you'd like to contact us, the phone number here is 867 1190, or you can visit the website on www.near.ie. On this week's show, we'll be looking at the Irish Civil War. During the second half, we'll be talking to John Borgonovo about the Civil War in Cork. But first, John and I will be discussing the Civil War in Dublin. So one of the first things that I think we could talk about is that period in Dublin between the signing of the treaty in January 1922 and when hostilities finally break out with the attack on the forecourts by the Free State Army on the 28th of June. How did the situation in Dublin deteriorate?
Well, a lot of people who have studied the Civil War, if you like, in the provinces, like John Borgonovo, for example, in Cork City, will tell you that the Civil War was something which very nearly didn't happen, where many people didn't want it to happen and so forth. In Dublin, I'm not 100% sure that that's the case, because in Dublin, you have the most militant of the IRA, not necessarily from Dublin, but they come to Dublin to oppose the treaty. Ernie O'Malley, Rory O'Connor, people like that, the people who organise the forecourts takeover. And obviously they're a very militant group. They've occupied the forecourts. They also occupied other prominent buildings in Dublin to sort of try to provoke a crisis with the British. At the same time as the anti-treaty IRA repudiated the Dáil, which they did in March, saying the Dáil had no right to approve the treaty because it disestablished the Republic. And the same day that happened, that night, there was attacks on government installations all over Dublin. There was an attack on Bank of Ireland, which was held by pro-treaty IRA men, Free State troops, if you like. There was an attack on Wellington Barracks, which is later Griffith Barracks, Beggar's Bush Barracks, which was the first Free State barracks. All of these, there was gunfire that night, there was no one killed, there was quite a few people wounded though. But I mean, you're used to talking about rifles, grenades, serious attacks. That calmed down because Michael Collins managed to organise a kind of a truce. He had a thing called the Army Reunification Committee, which sort of defused things for a little while. But I mean, my impression in Dublin is that, you know, it was very much on the cards that there was going to be some sort of violence at some point. Maybe not on the scale of a civil war in the sense of two very organised blocs who were going to fight each other. But I think it was always on the cards that somebody was going to have to stomp on someone, if you like, if they were going to get control of Dublin.
And among the general population of people in Dublin, was there a feeling that conflict was inevitable?
Well, I think one of the things about the whole revolutionary period, if you like, and this is true for the War of Independence as well, is that a lot of it was done by fairly small groups of activists. I mean, the general populace weren't necessarily consulted all the time. My feeling in Dublin is that, yeah, most people would have preferred it was avoided. I mean, the vote in Dublin was majority pro-treaty, although there was a substantial anti-treaty vote in June 1922 in the election. I don't think the general public, no, had any appetite for a war. You know, I mean, the general public as a whole was taken by surprise by the whole thing. People were surprised when the forecourts was attacked in late June. And, you know, certainly people, it wasn't like, say, the Spanish Civil War, where the people ran to the barricades, you know, to fight off a military uprising. There was nothing remotely resembling that in Dublin. It was more or less, it was a fight between fighters, you know, between committed activists, mm-hmm. and later between the troops of the government that were paid and disciplined, obviously, and the anti-treaty activists, the IRA fighters, you know.
Now, apart from the occupation of the forecourts, what else was the anti-treaty IRA in Dublin doing to maybe provoke a response from the new Free State government?
You know, the period leading up to the Civil War is all very murky. I mean, one of the things that was going on was that, you know, the period that we talk about is the truce, where there's supposed to be peace. It's actually the most violent time up in Belfast. And, you know, there's, without going down the road of who was doing what to who, there was a lot of people being killed, disproportionately Catholics, and Michael Collins was trying to get arms sent to the north. The Collins and Lynch, Liam Lynch, who was the head of the anti-treaty IRA, were cooperating to try to send arms to the north. And what they were doing was, the Collins had arranged for the people in the forecourts to hand over their weapons to the Free State. They were going to be sent to the north. The weapons the British were giving Collins to arm the Provisional Government's Army, or the Free State Army, was given to them. You know, and this is like 2 months before they started shooting at each other. So it's probably unfair to say that anyone had a premeditated plan for civil war. It sort of happened. On the other hand, like I said, the fact that these people were in the forecourts, they weren't going to move. And some of them, throughout the period, were taking shots at Free State troops. So it's quite a confused picture, is what I'm saying. But as regards what else were they doing, I mean, they were holding up banks for money. That was one of the biggest things that they were doing, which people such as Arthur Griffith were getting very upset about. They were requisitioning, that was the term, requisitioning stuff from shops. I mean, a lot of the time, like military gear, like trench coats and stuff that they would need. They were, you know, parading up and down the street armed. There's a famous photograph of the IRA in Grafton Street in their trench coats and their you know, their trilby hats. But, I mean, very well armed, you know, with rifles, revolvers and so on. It's quite a murky picture because on one hand, nobody had a plan for civil war, and nobody had a very good plan, certainly not on the anti-treaty side or Republican side. On the other hand, they were sort of provoking both the provisional government and the British. And remember, people forget that there was actually 6,000 British troops in Dublin for all of this time. You know, there was a very big British garrison, and actually they did play some part in the fighting in Dublin in the Civil War, which is not very widely appreciated, and there was one or two of them killed, in fact. But I think it's not quite fair to say that they were deliberately provoking civil war, the Republicans, but they were, the way they saw it was they were sort of maintaining a defiant posture throughout that time.
On the Free State side during this period, how much do you think there was a feeling that civil war must be avoided and they didn't want to crack down on Republicans? And how much do you think they were just biding their time until they had their forces properly armed and trained before they could move on the Republicans?
There's two kind of factions, if you like, within the provisional government or the Free Staters, if you like. Very simply, I mean, Collins on one side and Griffith on the other side. And Collins probably, he did all he could really to avoid civil war. I mean, he had this thing of the army reunification. He was trying to reunite the IRA, reorientated as well towards the north. What exactly he was planning for the north, we never really found out. Griffith, on the other hand, I mean, Griffith, Winston Churchill called him once, was the only true Free Stater. I mean, Griffith really believed in the compromise. He really believed that this was the best deal and that they should make it work. And these people who were against it were basically delinquents. You know, they were criminals and they had to be got rid of as early as possible. I mean, it's not necessarily easy to talk about two camps. There's two opinions. I mean, people who were very close to Collins, like Emmett Dalton, for example, wanted them cleared out of the forecourts right away. You know, there was definitely two camps. But because Collins was such a dominant personality in the Free State and the provisional government, it was Collins's policy which prevailed until there was no other option, which happened in late June 1922.
What sparked the attack on the forecourts? What external factors were like the last straw as far as the Free State government or provisional government were concerned?
Yeah, there's two very dramatic events happened. There was Field Marshal Wilson, Henry Wilson, was assassinated in London. Wilson had been the advisor to the Northern government, the new Northern Ireland government, which, as I say, had been very far from protecting their Catholic minority, in some cases participating in attacks on them. And he was assassinated in reprisal for that, although he had actually retired as military advisor from the Northern Ireland government. The British, Lloyd George and Winston Churchill, basically assumed, not unreasonably, I suppose, that this was the hardcore of the IRA, the people represented in the forecourts. Actually, it wasn't. I mean, there's some suggestion Collins himself ordered this. That's never been proved. There's people who dispute that now. It may just have been the London IRA doing it off their own bat. We don't really know. But anyway, I mean, the result of it was that Churchill, in particular, Lloyd George and Churchill, delivered an ultimatum to Collins saying, enough is enough. You've played with these people for too long. You've got all kinds of chaos happening in Ireland. You've got bank robberies. You've got these, what they would have seen as bandits, you know. You've got raids on British warships down in Cork and so on and so forth. You have to do something about it or we're going to do it. In fact, they actually ordered Macready, who was the British manager or British commander on site, was in the Phoenix Park with 6,000 troops, to not only take the forecourts, but to bombard it with howitzers. You know, this is First World War weaponry, to bombard it from the air. And Macready, who was a sensible chap by all accounts, said, I really don't think that's a very good idea. And of course, which he was completely right, because that was exactly what the anti-treaty Republicans wanted. But I mean, this is a very very difficult situation for Collins. I mean, he's been put in a situation where he's going to do the British bidding for them. Fortunately enough, in a way for Collins, the people in the forecourts kidnapped a Free State general or Provisional Government Army general, Ginger O'Connell, JJ Ginger O'Connell. And this sort of gave Collins an excuse. So it wasn't because of British pressure, it was because of the kidnapping of this guy O'Connell. And at this point, Collins accepted the loan of artillery from the British garrison in Dublin, and he started firing on the forecourts. And that was whatever kind of alternative scenarios we can imagine, which might have happened, how the Civil War could have been avoided, and people will argue endlessly about this. The fact is, it wasn't. Once they opened fire in the forecourts, that things more or less coalesced into a civil war, which is, by which I mean that instead of having lots of different opinions and different factions, you had two clear blocks who were going to fight each other over this.
How did the attack on the forecourts lead to widespread fighting in Dublin, and how long did that fighting last?
Fighting lasted about five, six days. The attack on the forecourts was basically, mostly it was an artillery barrage. The British, MacCready and them, and his garrison were pretty leery about giving Collins lots of shells. I mean, they didn't, you know, because Collins at the end of the day had been shooting at them less than a year before, or well, just over a year before. And they gradually increased the amount of shells. There was four guns, but I mean, and the latest book, Liz Gillis's book on the fall of Dublin, I mean, she shows that one gun fired 250 shells, and if there was four guns firing 250 shells at the forecourts, that's over 1,000 rounds, you know. As not all of it high explosive, actually. Some of them were shrapnel shells, which were just more for a psychological effect, because they wouldn't have done anything on the actual building. But it was bombarded. The Free State troops did actually have to storm the western part of the forecourts. I mean, they lost a few dead, and they lost three or four dead. And then, famously, the Public Records Office, which the anti-treaty people had been using as a munitions dump, exploded in a massive explosion, which looks like a nuclear explosion if you see the photograph. A big mushroom cloud rises over the quays. And there was 40 Free State troops maimed, is the term the newspapers at the time use, which means, I assume, that their arms and legs and stuff were blown off. You know, explosions are very bad things. How did it spread to the rest of Dublin? Oscar Traynor, who was the head of the Dublin Brigade, he was the anti-treaty head. He hadn't been the head, of course, before, but the most senior people in the Dublin IRA sided with Collins. As we know, people like Finney Byrne. But he occupied O'Connell Street, or people always use this word, he occupied O'Connell Street. In fact, the Republicans had buildings, and they had buildings since before even the Easter Rising, up in the northern part of O'Connell Street, and they tunnelled through those buildings to connect them, and they had a block, which they called, up at the northeastern corner of O'Connell Street and the Gresham Hotel, and they sent out patrols and so forth. They occupied other buildings on O'Connell Street. There was also, anti-treaty garrison, if you like, in Dolphin's Barn. There was another one on the Swan Hotel in Ager Street, which is still there. In fact, you can still see the bullets from what happened afterwards. And the fighting there in O'Connell Street and other places actually started before the forecourts had even surrendered. I mean, the forecourts surrendered when the fires from the bombardment got too much for them to bear. And there wasn't that many people killed in the forecourts. There was, I think, three of the forecourts garrison were killed, and a number of Free State troops. I can't tell you the exact number, but I mean, a substantial amount, maybe 10, many more injured. The fighting on O'Connell Street lasted for another 5 days. Again, the key was artillery, as it generally is in house-to-house fighting, because house is like, it's like a bunker. I mean, a house will generally stop a bullet, but it won't stop an artillery shell. Once you bring artillery to bear, that generally decides things. And what you tended to find in the Civil War was you didn't have last stands, you didn't have the Alamo or Stalingrad. Once things got too dangerous, basically, when there was too much of a chance of being killed, the anti-treaty people on O'Connell Street got away. And they got away kind of bizarrely by just hiding their guns and walking to the tram and getting the tram to Blessington. You know, I mean, Cathal famously stayed behind in the Gresham Hotel and was shot, you know, when he emerged, guns in hand, you know, Wild West style. Although, in fact, he was shot in the leg and he bled to death. But most of the anti-treaty fighters literally got the tram to Blessington.
Didn't Dorney O'Malley hope that there would be people from the south would come up and try and retake Dublin?
Yeah, and they did get a column together. I mean, not a huge one, but I mean, I think about 100 or more fighters from Tipperary. And they did meet them in Blessington. And the plan was, yeah, that they'd march back on Dublin. I mean, O'Malley, which is another good story, O'Malley had been in the forecourts and had surrendered. But he just asked the Free State troops who he knew to let him go, and they did. And that's, you know, there's an almost farcical tone to the early fighting in Dublin. But yeah, they met them in Blessington. They were supposedly going to march in Dublin. And you get all this in the Irish Civil War a lot, this kind of grandiose rhetoric, you know, from the Napoleonic type rhetoric. We're going to march on Dublin. I mean, in fact, the Free State troops came out to Blessington. There was a skirmish of British, which is on the road to Blessington. There was another skirmish of Ballymore Eustace, which is just down the road from that. And basically, you know, I mean, you had a number of casualties, 3-4 killed, something like that. And the anti-treaty guys said, this is going to be too tough. And they just retreated. They went away. I mean, they went down to Wexford. They took a couple of towns in Wexford and they hung on there for a little while. And then a seaborne column was sent down there and they decided that that wasn't the best idea either, and they evacuated there. And that, if you like, was more or less the end of the military story of the Civil War in Dublin.
When you're looking at Civil War throughout Ireland, that once the anti-treatyites lost a town, there didn't seem to be, except in very rare instances, major attempts to retake that town or city.
No. I mean, it's easy to criticise people in retrospect. I mean, an offensive operation in a military situation is much more difficult than a defensive operation, both in terms of organisation and also psychologically. You have to have quite well-disciplined people to do it. And you have to have people who are prepared to be killed for whatever reason. I mean, normally, in a normal army, it's just because of discipline, just because they're not thinking about being killed, really. They're used to following orders. I mean, in a volunteer army, if you like, it's very difficult, and they found this throughout the War of Independence and the Civil War, it's very difficult to ask people to, like, fix your bayonets and charge at something when there's a pretty good chance you're going to be killed. You know, I mean, it was, oddly enough, it was easier for the Free State troops who were more conventionally organised. I mean, there were people who were paid and they were recruited for money, and they tended to do it a bit more. Not an awful lot more, but a bit more. But yeah, I mean, it's pretty rare to see effective counterattacks by anti-treaty people in the Civil War.
So after the engagements around O'Connell Street and the forecourts and at the end of that five-day period, how did the Civil War develop then in Dublin?
Yeah, well, the casualties of the conventional fighting in Dublin hadn't been huge, but, you know, they were substantial. There was about 60 people killed. There was over 250 injured. There was 400 or so Republicans arrested. I mean, not all fighters, actually. I mean, people who would have been sympathisers and that were rounded up and arrested. Shortly afterwards, in August, I mean, Liam Lynch, who was the head of the anti-treaty IRA, ordered all the bridges in Dublin, North Dublin especially, to be destroyed. And they were doing this, but the air intelligence officer had actually been captured by National Army Intelligence, who we might talk about more about in the future. And the National Army, or the Free State Army, knew what was going on, and they basically just rounded up over 100 guerrilla activists in late August. And in a lot of ways, I mean, in many accounts of the Civil War in Dublin, they say that finished the IRA in Dublin. It didn't, actually. That's not really true. But, I mean, it certainly dealt it a hard blow. I mean, if Ernie O'Malley wrote to Liam Lynch in and around that time that 90% of their officers were in jail in Dublin by late August, by September 1922. So what you saw after that was a lot of the anti-treaty people were really, really young. Like Frank Sherwin, who was later an independent politician in Dublin, was 16 years old. And he was actually recruited in the Free State Army. But he deserted when the attack on the forecourts came, which I think was not quite widespread, but it did happen quite a lot. And he was operating with the unit of the FINA, which was the youth wing of the IRA. I mean, you're talking about lads who were 16, 17, 18 years old, and they were living in the Dublin mountains, where there seemed to have been a couple of columns who were living rough up there and launching attacks in the city. If you look at the casualties, I mean, it's quite rare. I mean, and there's like I said, you're not talking about massive numbers, but you're talking about substantial numbers. The casualties on both sides, both in the provisional government of the Free State Army and in the IRA, rarely over 20, you know, really young lads. Most of them hadn't been old enough to fight in the War of Independence because the older guys were in prison mostly by that time. And if you look at the stuff that they were doing, it was generally kind of reckless as well, as you'd expect from very young guys. You know, you're talking about in Dublin City, when a troop lorry is going past, these guys are throwing grenades at them, homemade grenades, which could often go off on themselves, and firing revolvers at it. And there was a lot of civilians injured. There was one day particular in September when there was three attacks in about an hour, one in Drumcondra where 10 civilians were injured, badly injured. There's a soldier killed. Another attack in Eden Quay, a soldier killed there, civilians killed there. Another attack on Merchant's Quay. You know, I mean, in a pretty small area, and quite a few attacks, quite intense, you know. And by the autumn of 1922, this is what you're seeing in Dublin. You're seeing ambushes in the streets. You're seeing attempts at assassinations. You're seeing attacks on the barracks, which means that the anti-treaty fighters crawled up to the rooftops of surrounding houses and fired at the barracks, the former British barracks, which were now occupied by Irish troops. Mostly without effect. They just shot at them. They just put holes in the walls. And one attack, though, on Wellington Barracks, they managed to shoot up the morning parade, and they hit quite a lot of soldiers. I mean, they hit 19 or 20, only one of whom died, actually, but had they been better shots, they would have killed 20, 30. But you're looking at, by the standards of Irish political violence in the 20th century, you're looking at pretty serious security situation in Dublin in the autumn of 1922.
In response, how did the provisional government react then to the violence on the street and this guerrilla campaign by the anti-treatyites?
Well, pretty brutally, you know, and it's not to take sides to say that necessarily, but the Free State government, or the Free State troops, had a big advantage in that the intelligence unit of the IRA before the truce, the squad, the assassination unit also, sided with Michael Collins. They sided with the pro-treaty side, more or less all of them. And they ended up in two bodies in Dublin, the CID, which was in theory part of the police, Criminal Investigation Department, plainclothes, counterinsurgency really, and the National Army Intelligence, which was based in Wellington Barracks on the South Circular Road, later Griffith Barracks, now Griffith College. And basically, they did two things. They mostly arrested suspects, but when they did arrest fighters or sympathisers of Republicans, they were very brutally treated in terms of interrogation. I mean, we have Frank Sherwin, who I mentioned before, who was arrested after an attack on a barracks, was hit with bayonets, hit with barbed wire. You know, I mean, he lost the use of his arm as a result of his interrogation. Another guy, Frank Derrick, who was more senior in the IRA, was they shot a gun in front of his face, and he lost an eye. You know, it's fairly brutal stuff. But because of both their knowledge of the IRA and because of fairly brutal interrogation, their intelligence was good, and they locked up really most of the Republican fighters. The other thing that they did was that generally, in response to attacks on Free State troops, and especially the attacks on the CID or the former squad people who were very close to each other, when one of them was killed, what you usually see is a Republican was assassinated in response. There's the weekend after Michael Collins was killed, there was three members of the Fianna. Now, the Fianna were involved in the guerrilla campaign, so they weren't innocents like they're sometimes painted. But three young guys, 16, 17, Cole and Collie, and another guy who was slightly older, were taken, and they were assassinated in Whitehall. They were dumped in a field. Charlie Dalton, who was the head of National Army Intelligence, found three guys putting up a poster, Republican posters, in Drumcondra. And he drove them out to the Red Cow and shot them there. The guys were 16, one guy who was 17. A guy called Frank Lawler, who was killed probably in response to a shooting of a CID man, who was living in Ranelagh, and they drove him out to Rathgar, near to where I'm from, actually. And there's a small memorial to him there, and he was assassinated. So, I mean, you're looking at not particularly sophisticated, but fairly brutal counterinsurgency, if you like, and quite effective on the whole.
In that regard, when we talk about the assassination of somebody like Noel Lamass, were people targeted specifically because of their family connections?
Yeah, we might not ever know what the truth is, but I mean, if you look at the people who were killed, apart from, I mean, there's the Fianna people who seem to have been totally at random, you know, but there's also, like, Lawler was quite senior in the IRA, I think. Noel Lamass was reputedly an assassin, reputedly shot Sean Hales. We might talk about that a little bit. Martin Hogan, who was an important IRA guy, who was killed in March 1923. I mean, they do seem to have known who they were shooting, and they shot them in reprisal. So yeah, I mean, it was a, if you like, a personal thing.
So what effect did this crackdown by the provisional government and the CID and Army Intelligence, what effect did that have on the morale of anti-treatyites in Dublin?
Yeah, it's a good question. I mean, there's kind of two contradictory things. I mean, on the one hand, not just actually the unofficial reprisals, but the government executions. I mean, famously, the IRA assassinated Sean Hales, the TD, and they tried to kill another one in December. And the day after, in response, the government shot Liam Mellows, Roy O'Connor, Dick Barrett and John McKelvey, who had been the leaders in the forecourts. So, you know, and this is the way that, unfortunately, that the Irish Civil War was. It was about reprisals, and it was about who could do the more reprisals, you know. And that does seem to have demoralised the anti-treaty IRA. I mean, Frank Henderson, who was the head of the IRA Dublin Brigade, said he could have shot more TDs, but he decided not to after that, because their own people would have suffered, their prisoners would have been shot. In terms of the assassinations, I'm not sure if it decreased the morale. I mean, for sure, though, it definitely increased the hatred that people felt. I mean, all of the anti-treaty people who left memoirs, Todd Andrews, Frank Sherwin, Ernie O'Malley and so forth, will all talk about the hatred that they felt for these people because in the years afterwards, because of what had happened. They talk about Noel Lamass and the three Fianna boys and so forth. I mean, this was very much burned into their psyche. I mean, again, you're not talking about huge numbers. You're looking at 25 people who were assassinated like that in Dublin. But I mean, everybody knew who everyone was. So because of that, it was something that people remembered with a lot of bitterness for a long time.
What was the bitterness on the pro-treaty side in terms of assassinations?
Yeah, I mean, this is a good question because this is sometimes underplayed. There was, in Dublin itself, I mean, Sean Hales, the TD, who was from a proper Republican family in Cork. His brother Tom was actually in the anti-treaty IRA. He was assassinated. Pádraig O'Mála, who was, again, impeccable Republican credentials, tried to kill him. W.T. Cosgrave's father was shot dead at his shop. There was a pro-treaty politician, Seamus Dwyer, who had failed to be elected in the 1922 election. He was assassinated, or he was shot anyway, in his shop in Rathmines. But possibly not as many, I would say, assassinations by the anti-treaty side. For whatever reason, I mean, I don't mean to kind of say that one side was better than the other for moral reasons, but there doesn't seem to be as many assassinations in Dublin by the anti-treaty side. But certainly, yes, the pro-treaty side would have seen all the IRA was doing in terms of assassination of politicians, the killing of troops in the street. I mean, they would have seen young guys who, again, were rarely over 20, if you look at the sources. The burning of senators' houses. I mean, there was an attempt to kill Horace Plunkett, who was the head of the cooperative movement. Oliver St. John Gogarty, who was a senator, was kidnapped. They threatened to kill him. They shot up a boxing match in March 1923 because the anti-treaty IRA put a ban on public entertainment because they said it was a period of national mourning. So, I mean, the Civil War, certainly, you know, there's nobody comes out of it clean. Nobody comes out of it looking very good. And both sides had bitterness to hold on to afterwards.
But how much can the provisional government be blamed for the actions of the CID and the army? How much was known at the cabinet level? Because you have similar issues going on in Kerry at the time.
Yeah.
And the question has to be raised, how much of it was a Dublin thing? Because the worst offenders down in Kerry were Dublin officers and the Dublin Brigade.
Although you do see reprisals by people who were not from Dublin during the Civil War, the people who did the most of it were really the ex-squad people. I mean, the people who had done the most killing for Collins, they did also did the most killing in the Civil War. Was the government aware of it? Yeah, I think we can be pretty much sure that they were. There's lots of letters going back and forth. I mean, Seamus Robinson wrote to Richard Mulcahy. Seamus Robinson was on the anti-treaty side, and he wrote to Richard Mulcahy, who was the head of the National Army, saying that this was going on in Kerry. My suspicion is that they knew, in terms of the extrajudicial assassinations of the police and the army in Dublin, but they didn't want to mess with them, really, because they were wild men in the squad. They were scary people, basically. And it wasn't until after the Civil War when they managed to actually get rid of most of them. They basically retired them. Not many of them. There was the odd one who was left in the National Army afterwards, like David Nelligan, for example. But most of them were sort of pensioned off because they were out of control. So my impression is the government sort of tolerated them for the Civil War rather than like what they were doing.
Thank you very much. That was very, very interesting. And just for the listeners, if you could just mention briefly about your website, which has a lot of Civil War material on it.
Yeah, we have the website, theirishstory.com. We do have a lot on the Civil War because something that was, for obvious reasons, people didn't want to talk about for a long time, but I mean, there was a dearth of it. So I think people like myself and yourself tend to be drawn to it just to find out what actually did happen. And yeah, you can find us on www.theirishstory.com.
Thank you very much, John.
You're welcome. John Borgonovo joins us from Cork. John is the author of Spies, Informers and the Sinn Féin Society, a book about the War of Independence in Cork City. He's now written a book on the battle for Cork City in August 1922 in the Civil War. He teaches history at UCC. John, thanks for joining us.
Thanks, John.
What drew you to writing about the Civil War after your book about the War of Independence in Cork City?
Well, I was actually approached by Mercer. They're doing a series of books on the military battles of the Civil War, because there hasn't been a lot of work done on the actual conflict since Michael Hopkinson's book, Green Against Green, the late 80s. So there really hasn't been that much new work done. And Mercer is releasing this whole series that's for a broader audience than an academic audience. I'm really pleased with that because I get a lot of feedback from folks here in Cork who are very fond of their history. And a lot of the history isn't written for them. It's written for other historians, which they kind of find frustrating. So I saw this as a good opportunity.
Your last book, if we can start the story sort of at the end of that, was about the War of Independence in Cork City, and that was ended very abruptly on July the 11th, 1921, with the truce. Was that a big surprise for the Cork men in the IRA?
Well, the truce seemed to have been anticipated to some extent. Like, they had an idea. There was negotiations going on. The terms on which the truce was agreed weren't approved necessarily. So they would have been notified that some negotiations are going on without really having a say on the matter. I think the more surprising thing, it seems that there wasn't really any effort to consult with provincial leaders of the IRA about the treaty itself and about the treaty negotiations. And the folks who were in charge of the IRA down here in Cork, which was kind of the most powerful element of the IRA nationally, ended up being very surprised by the treaty negotiations and the treaty terms specifically.
Mm-hmm. And somewhat disappointed, I think.
Oh, yeah, very disappointed. And according to Flory O'Donoghue, who was kind of the center of a lot of this, big leader in the Munster IRA, Collins had come down to Cork right before he went to London and kind of assured everybody, the main leaders, that there wasn't going to be any kind of settlement, it would have a chance of approving a settlement. But he also mentioned to a couple of the top leaders, to O'Donoghue and Liam Lynch, that there might not be a republic. He might not be coming back with the Republic. And they found that very shocking. That was the first indication they had that there was going to be something short of a Republic. But that wasn't necessarily expressed to the wider audience as well. And this was also just before Collins left. So it doesn't seem like there was that much effort to reach out and prepare folks for a Dominion resolution to the crisis.
The IRA at the time and since have been known as the lads and the boys. In a way, these were young men, mostly working class young men. Did they feel they were being sidelined by the treaty and all that went on?
Yeah, I think that's a fair assessment. I also think that there was a sense also that, yes, they were young. Most of them there were working class, were of a lower social class than the, definitely from the previous kind of Irish Party leadership, but he also from the what was emerging as kind of the Sinn Féin elite. The TDs were, a lot of them had university degrees, were from the professions, but the real kind of top leadership of the IRA would have been down another social notch once you got outside of the Dublin leadership. At the provincial level, it seemed to be been down notch from the Sinn Féin leadership, and I think that played into some of the tensions, and I also think that that played into some of the public opposition to the IRA in that they were perceived as having risen above their station. The idea that they were calling the shot was seen as turning the normal social status upside down, and I think that was part of the dynamic going forward.
The truce period itself was a period when the IRA was sort of in control of much of the country and in control of Cork City and County. For some people, particularly on the Free State side, this was not only a turning of society upside down, but a breakdown of law and order. There were bank robberies, land seizures, and most controversially of all in Cork, the question of the killing of Protestants and sectarian killings.
The British evacuated very rapidly. So they evacuated within a day or two of the treaty being approved at Doyle. And within about 2 weeks or 3 weeks, you know, the Oxies, the public face of the Crown forces, were gone. Totally. The RIC were disbanded with about 6 weeks or 8 weeks, and troops were pretty much gone within about 2 months, from except for a few areas. So that created just a power vacuum, basically. And you know, keep in mind also that the IRA weren't a full-time organization. They were, most of them were still working, had jobs. They weren't full-time members of the IRA to keep order. There was no Irish police force. The British had abandoned and pulled right out, and things like land tension really erupted. There was a lot of labor radicalism. There were a number of Soviets declared up in Tipperary, North Cork, and Limerick. Here in Cork, there was a railway workers were basically declared a Soviet of all the railways in Munster right the day before a settlement was announced. We also had a Port of Cork Soviet the previous summer. So there was labor radicalism, there was land agitation, and then as you're right, there was a seemingly sectarian series of killings in West Cork, which were controversial, which Peter Hart kind of first brought to public attention following the killing of a Cork IRA officer by some local Protestants in a kind of confusing home invasion for a car, it seems like, and about 9 or 10 West Cork Protestant farmers were killed, but it definitely added to the sense that there was instability and there was violence and there was anarchy. And now you also got to factor in at the same time, this was pretty much the height of the troubles up north, and these were the worst months in Belfast. It seemed like really bad things were happening. Maybe there was going to be expulsion of the Catholics up in Ulster. That was the fear, at least. So you had all this sectarian anxiety also rising, along with social and economic agitation. There was also like ordinary crime. There were criminals going around robbing places. Some of them were in the IRA, some of them weren't. So it seems like there was a lack of law and order, and that really contributed to the general anxiety and the general kind of desire for stability.
So was civil war then inevitable between the government and, as they would have seen it, the mutineers, the irregulars, the forces of anarchy?
No, I wouldn't necessarily put the IRA down as this main force of anarchy. I think they were part of a destabilizing element, but there was all kinds of things. Basically, there was no government functioning. That was the big thing. The Civil War was very close to not happening. When you look at the pact election, when you look at the Army Unification Agreement, which was approved, they were very close to avoiding a Civil War. Both sides were surprised when the Civil War actually broke out. May and June, it really looked like it wasn't going to happen. It was only really the British insisting that the terms of the treaty would be upheld, really pinning Michael Collins, the provisional government, down when they were trying to work their way over to the Republicans. And then this was kind of driven in when Field Marshal Wilson was assassinated in London by the London IRA, who seemed to have been doing that off their own bat. Word came from London that the provisional government was going to have to move against those folks occupying the four courts. And I think the interesting thing about the four courts was that at that time, there wasn't two IRAs, pro-treaty IRA and an anti-treaty IRA. There was also, the anti-treaty IRA was split into a moderate and a hardline faction. And the moderates were mainly the Munster IRA, the Cork IRA, folks in Kerry and Limerick and Tipperary. And then the real hardline elements were the guys who occupied the four courts, Ernie O'Malley, Liam Mills, Rory O'Connor. And they actually locked Liam Lynch and the Southern officers out of the four courts. And so it seemed like when the shelling happened that the Munster element and the kind of moderate element wasn't going to get involved. but they'd actually been working their way towards reunification, and then they engaged. And then once they decided to engage, the fighting quickly spread beyond Dublin. And I think that surprised not just outside observers, but I think it really surprised the participants themselves.
But down in Cork, would I be right in saying that almost all of the IRA was anti-treaty?
Yeah, all the brigades were anti-treaty. There was maybe part of one or two of the battalions were pro-treaty. Cork No. 1 Brigade. In the city itself, there were 16 IRA companies, and 15 of them were anti-treaty. So, yes, virtually the whole IRA was anti-treaty. That being said, a lot of guys went neutral, and especially when the fighting broke out, more and more of the membership of the rank and file decided not to participate. They were against the treaty, but they didn't see how the Civil War was going to solve anything. And there was also a fear that the Civil War might give the British a reason to reoccupy the country and have support for reoccupying the country. That one of the constant kind of reasons given for not giving Ireland home rule or self-government was that they were incapable of it, that they were incapable of governing themselves. And so there was a fear that this civil war was going to prove the fact that the Irish were incapable of governing themselves and give justification to a reoccupation. And among the leadership down here, as I said, I mentioned Flory O'Donoghue, who was a main provincial leader. He went neutral, and then the officer commanding the Cork No. 1 Brigade, Sean Hegarty, who was a real dynamic force and really the main man here in the city in mid-Cork, he went neutral as well. And then so that kind of created a little bit of a vacuum. And then more and more guys went neutral as the fight kind of erupted.
At the start of August of July of 1922, Cork was sort of seen as the capital of the anti-treaty stronghold in Munster. And it was retaken or taken, I suppose, by the provisional government in a very dramatic series of events. Can you tell the story of how Cork was taken by the Free State troops?
Cork was seen as kind of this bastion, and it was kind of the Gibraltar of the Republican resistance and the real capital, I guess. So,
God forbid. Huh?
I know, exactly. Validating generations of Corkonian thought. Finally, they're becoming the real capital. But there weren't really any Free State units down here. There were a few and kind of over in Kerry and the Limerick. Those were swept out and those units were captured. Kind of the best fighters from here went up to Limerick, and the idea was they were going to go up, take Limerick, and then move up into Galway and into Clare and up into Connacht, kind of solidify that whole resistance on the east-west axis. They lost Limerick. Over the coming weeks, they fought kind of a holding action in the north part of Cork and kind of southern tip of Limerick, called the Line, which went from Waterford to Limerick. And there was fighting up there for about 5 weeks. And the Free State Army kept getting stronger. They were financed and armed by the British government. They were getting more and more troops online. And the IRA was kind of static. And they were slowly getting pushed back. At the same time, the entire coastline on the south was exposed. Now, one of the things that would surprise me was because part of the kind of the conventional narrative is that nobody foresaw a seaborne invasion. But when I did my research, that wasn't true. Actually, IRA anticipated landings, sea landings behind them. They manned likely landing points, put garrisons down. They mined piers. They set up road blockades. They ended up blowing up at the number of landing piers as well across Munster. But there were just too many places where troops might land. So when the landings did happen, the first one was down in Fennet, down in Kerry, the 2nd of August. And then a week later, troops came in. About 800 troops came from Dublin. And they landed in three spots. They landed in Skibbereen, in Youghal, and in Passage West, which is in Cork Harbor. They landed on the 8th of August in the middle of the night and were able to dock without being fired on. And then they quickly overcame an IRA garrison in Passage and were able to unload. And that kind of set off the stage for this three-day fight that took place over the next. There was a three-day battle with about 400 Free State troops facing about 300 IRA troops. And they fought in the hills in the suburbs of Cork for three full days. And that's what my book's about, is kind of just that whole operation, that whole, the context and the actual events in that little 3 day period.
And the Free State troops won surprisingly easily, I would say.
Yes, it surprised people. It surprised people how easily they came through, because there's a perception that the Cork IRA was the best the IRA had to offer. They knew that they'd done well. They stood up to British troops well. And there was also the thinking that there was actually the city was going to be destroyed, that they were going to fight in the city, and the whole city was going to get destroyed. That was what was anticipated. And there were a lot of international journalists. There was, you know, everyone around the world was watching this event. It was seen as kind of the climax of the Civil War. People thought that the IRA troops were going to fall back on Cork, fight from Cork, and then be, and that was going to be where the final battle was going to be done, and that was going to be the end of the Civil War. And so there were all kinds of journalists over watching that, and there was, everyone was expecting a big, huge battle. National Army landed south. There was a fight, and it was actually a significant fight. Probably about a dozen Free State soldiers were killed. Both sides, if you combine the two sides, I estimate probably about 20 people, maybe 15 to 20 people were killed, but probably 50 or 60 were wounded. So it was a major encounter, let's put it that way. And there was artillery used and armor cars and all kinds of stuff. So it was relatively easy, but a little bit harder than I think is perceived. And then the other element of it is that the IRA also decided not to fight in the city. So they fought on the outskirts of the city, and then they didn't want to necessarily have the city be destroyed. So they moved out, and they evacuated the city rather than fight for it. And that also saved a hell of a lot of lives, as well as property, and prevented a lot of destruction, and needless destruction.
The fact that the casualties were relatively low permitted the IRA to start a guerrilla campaign, and they were very gradually worn down over the next 9 months. Your book actually doesn't go into that, though. So if we had a revolution in Ireland, was this the end of the revolution? Like, you know, the thermidor in the French Revolution, the idea when the revolution stops and people turn back the clock or restore stability?
Yeah, I think so. I think this was kind of seen as a real bandit country, and this was the heartland of the revolution. You know, this is where a lot of the British troops were down here in the War of Independence. This was seen as really the bastion of the independence movement and the physical force element of the independence movement. And Cork City was kind of a big symbol of it. So when the city was conquered and taken, or liberated, according to your point of view, when the Republicans evacuated the city, and the way they did it too, you know, they also evacuated. They ran out of the city, and it was very demoralizing for them. And it surprised them, I think. It really sucked the oxygen out of the revolution. And I think the thinking with the rebel planners was that they could fall back on, they'd fight this conventional campaign, and then if that didn't work, they'd go back to a guerrilla campaign, guerrilla fighting, which they did best. I don't think they anticipated losing as much public support they did. And I think once they lost that conventional phase, really the public demanded that the fighting end and the fighting stop, and they stopped supporting the Republicans. And once that support disappeared, that was it. They couldn't conduct a guerrilla war, and it was, you're right, the guerrilla campaign was over in a few months, which I think, again, really surprised them. They thought they could continue for years. They had no idea, but once they lost the public support, and once the public support wanted stability and wanted the fighting to end, they were so isolated that they were easily defeated in fairly short order.
Mm-hmm. Most people who've taken an interest will know songs like The Boys of Kilmichael, famously about Tom Barry's ambush in 1920. I don't think there's any songs about, you know, the boys of the Battle of Douglas or anything like that.
No, you know, it's a very, you know, even people who live down there are don't even know about it. It's a forgotten history, but, you know, what's funny, too, is so much written about Michael Collins and Bell and the Blah. You only really understand what happened to Collins if you understand the context of this fight, because when the IRA withdrew from Cork, they destroyed all the roads and bridges in the region. I mean, my count is like 35 bridges were taken down in about 3 or 4 days, and they sealed off the whole road network in Cork. So when Collins very recklessly went out on a tour of West Cork, stopping in a few pubs away, he passed by a meeting of IRA officers from West Cork IRA, the Cork No. 3 Brigade, and because the roads were so thoroughly destroyed, they were anticipated, they knew he had to go back the same way he came, and that was why they were able to set up the ambush that finally killed him, and that's what most people remember about the Civil War, but it's only in the context of this kind of bigger story that this more compelling national narrative becomes clear.
Mm-hmm. I was in Kerry quite recently, actually, and people in Kerry will still tell you about the Ballyseedy massacre and the bitterness of that period. Is there any equivalent in Cork?
I kind of touch on one episode just at the end of the book where one of the brigade officers was tortured and killed, perhaps with Emma Dalton's direct involvement. He was named in an inquest. Definitely the guys who tortured and killed this officer, Timothy Kennefic, were identified as members of Collins' squad. And this was in September. Another episode I didn't mention in the book was around the same time, and members of the squad also tortured and killed another real prominent IRA guy here in the city, Sean O'Donohue. So yeah, there was some atrocities committed here, but not the level of what happened in Kerry. And then once Dalton left, Dalton was actually, I was surprised, he's always kind of portrayed as a very, you know, urbane, you know, mustache, nice mustache and golf playing gentleman, but he has a hardness in him that I found surprising. But what happened here in Cork was he was replaced by a UCC grad from the city called Davy Reynolds, and he seemed to have cooled things down and didn't really encourage the more aggressive guys. And I think the other thing that's really clear is the guys around Collins, the guys who were on the squad, were real killers, and they were responsible for the worst of the atrocities in the civil wars, the tortures and dumping people on the side of the road. And I think that has some implications for War of Independence scholarship and some questions that we should probably ask, not just about the War of Independence, but also about Collins himself.
Sure. And very finally, we've alluded to the fact that the Civil War fell into a kind of amnesia, really. Nobody wanted to remember it. Nobody wanted to talk about it or sing about it or anything like that. The centenary is coming up. Do you think we should remember the Civil War and draw more lessons from it?
Yeah, I think the narrative has been very, 90s especially, it was very pro-treaty, basically. Sure. And the idea that this was strictly a battle between democracy and people who were anti-democratic. I think it's a lot more complex than that. I think some of the IRA element was anti-democratic. I think some of them were non-political. I think there was also kind of the settlement that was signed, that was pressed, was pretty much almost guaranteed for a civil war. So I think a more nuanced view of things is due, it's overdue. I think you're seeing some of that. There's a recent book by Bill Cassan challenges a lot of that kind of conventional interpretation and the historiography. And I think that's going to change a little bit and become a little more subtle about not just the fact that about the elements of the anti-treaty side, but also the elements of the pro-treaty side, what was motivating participants on either side. I think there's a lot more ambiguity than has been previously appreciated.
Somebody under the bed, whoever can it be? I feel so very nervous, I call for Joanie. Joanie lights the candle, but there's nobody there. Hey, hi, diddly, hi, and out goes she. Skipping rope, still turning, chilling at their play. In and out of Clarendon Street, in and out to pray. I haven't prayed for 20 years or sung a happy song since praying went with innocence and a devil played along. And we all went up to the Mayo. Hey there, who is your man? It's only Johnny 40 coats, sure he's a desperate man. Bang bang shoots the buses with his golden key. Hey hi diddly aye, and out goes she. Me father was a stater, and me mother loved a tan. She loved her ham and her sausages, and her soldier fancy man. Nora's up in Jacob's, and Mary's on the town. And I joined the transport union when they said me nose was brown. And we all went up to the marrow. Hey there, who is your man? It's Alfie Burton out walking, sure he's a decent man. Bang bang shoots the buses with his golden key. Hey, hi, diddly, hi, and out goes she. I've a tanner for the marrow, and me compo money's hid. If Mary's in the family way, she can blame the Cisco kid. I be langers in the morning, me longers need a patch. Oh, Jesus, there, Con Martin, I hope yous win the match. Me uncle had a wolfhound that never had to pee, but Harry Lemon snatched it down on Eden Quay. Now I have me primo, and me scapulars are blue, for helping the black babies, and Dolly Fossett too. And we all went up to the Mayo. Hey there, who is your man? Spending being out walking, sure he's the ginger man. Bang bang shoots the buses with his golden key. Hey hi, diddly aye, and out goes she. It's true that Dublin's changing since the pillar was blown down by the winds of violence that are buggering up the town. We used to solve a difference with a digging match and a jar, but now they're all playing bang bang, that's going to bleeding far. And we'll all go up to the Mayo. Hey there, who's your man? It's only me guardian angel, get a large one for your man. There's no use bleeding Russian, sure now it's the holy hour, a plenary indulgence and another baby power.
whispered in my ear, 'twas the saddest thing he knew. When Ireland's proudest son was shot at the age of 32, he held my hand, his eyes held tears, and my eyes filled up too with a powerful emotion for a man I never knew. Michael Collins, fearless son, you touched the nation's soul. 10,000 pounds upon your head, you still achieved your goal. 'Twas not behind the barricades you fought the wanton fight. You beat the enemy at their game, you undermined their might. Was in a crowded banquet hall, the old man, meek and mild, a simple man from off the land, with the blue eyes of a child, brought a memory that an Irish gun shot down the rebel sun, and Ireland lost her laughing boy before his work was done. Michael Collins, fearless son, you touched the nation's soul. 10,000 pounds upon your head, you still achieved your goal. You knew the orange and the green would keep us yet apart, but the dream of Ireland one and free was the dream that filled your heart. And an old man in a banquet hall some 50 years gone by held a sadness that would never pass in his blue eyes filled to cry, with the memory that an Irish gun shot down the favorite son, and Ireland lost her laughing boy before his work was done. Michael Collins, fearless son, you touched the nation's soul. 10,000 pounds upon your head, you still achieved your goal. 'Twas not behind the barricades you fought the wanton fight. At their game, you undermined their might. You beat the enemy at their game, you undermined their might.
Oh, the Republic! Their battle cry, Pearse and McDermott will play for you on high. Eager and ready, for love of you they die. Proud march the soldiers of the rearguard, Legion of the rearguard, and swing Ireland's horn. Hark and marshals and bisters from Cork to Dorney.
The morning through flame and shot and shell, now rally Ireland, your sons who love you well. Pledge they'll defend you though death or prison cell. Wait for the soldiers of the rearguard, Legion of the rearguard.
on, cavalry, go! Soldiers of the Legion, now the rear guard. Crimson the roadside, the prison wall, the cave. Proof of their valor, go sleep in peace, ye brave. Comrade, tread lightly, you're near a hero's grave. Proud die the soldiers of the rear guard, Legion of the rear guard, and spring Ireland's fall. Hark the martial trumpets, from Cork to Donegal, Bullfrown and Bemmel guide you, go your task behind. Of the Legion of the Rear Guard.